Our call to worship today comes from Psalm 116, and I'm reading the first two verses. I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy. Because he turned his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live. Let us respond to that call to worship by praising the Lord in song. Let us join together in singing that wonderful hymn, Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but
And God's people all said, Amen. A very good morning to each and every one of you. I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and truly how wonderful it is to be with you once again this morning as we've gathered to praise, to worship, and just become silent at the feet of Almighty God. A great big welcome to you as we praise Him this morning. But before we get started, may I inquire how everybody is doing? Are you okay, and are you still coping under the current lockdown? How's the health? Is your health still okay? If not, just give it to the Lord and pray about it. And if you're feeling a bit anxious, the Lord is the right one. He has got the right medicine just for you. But let's not wait too long. Let us continue to praise the Lord and worship the Lord. For those of you that are still battling to wake up this morning, or perhaps have had a hectic day and it's evening, whenever you're watching this service, come, let's sing something that's lively. Let's get our voices going. Let's get our feet going. Let us really praise and worship the Lord today with dancing and with singing. We join together in proclaiming that God's people sings His praises. Let us come before the Lord in prayer. Come, let us pray. O most gracious and heavenly Father, Lord, we greet you this morning, Lord, as we've gathered about you as your people, Lord, your people to praise you and to worship you, Lord. But Lord, we come this morning proclaiming your majesty, proclaiming that you are the King of kings and the Lord of lords, and it is you that we worship this morning. But Lord, as we come praising you and worshiping you and basking in your wonderful grace, we also know, Lord, that in a week that has gone by, we have sinned against you. We have hurt one another. We have not loved as we ought to have loved. And therefore, Lord, we need to beg your forgiveness. Because, Lord, you gave us the opportunity and said that if we turn from our wicked ways, you will forgive us. O Lord, well, this morning we repent. Repent of all those sins that we've committed, both knowingly and unknowingly. So, Lord, in our silence now, Lord, we just want to offer you our personal and individual confessions. Hear our hearts now, Lord, we pray. O dear Lord God, we've emptied our hearts before you. O Lord, we pray that you will remove our sins from us as far as the east is from the west. O dear Lord God, we pray, Lord, that you will please forgive us and that you will justify us once again. O Lord, you've given us the assurance of our forgiveness in your scriptures. So many places you've promised to forgive us. Lord, we proclaim that this morning. We go into a world knowing that we are forgiven by Almighty God. Not perfect, but forgiven, Lord. O Lord, help us to understand that we need not feel guilty because you have forgiven us. Help us to know, Lord, that we are not inferior because you have justified us. Help us, dear Lord God, to face the world and not give one yard back, but rather to look forward and to embrace the world in confidence. Oh Lord, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity that we can come this morning, Lord, and praise you and worship you. And thank you, Lord, that you are with us. We just pray that you will bless our service today and that, Lord, you will hold each and every one of us tightly. Oh Lord, we thank you that you are our God. We thank you for this wonderful morning that you've given to us, this wonderful day, Lord. We thank you that we are part of your creation. We thank you most of all, Lord, that you love us and that you love us unconditionally. So, Lord, we pray, be with us now. In the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our lesson today is taken from the Gospel of Matthew chapter 18. Verses 21 to 35. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times? Jesus answered, I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient with me, he begged. And I will pay back everything. The servant's master took pity on him, cancelled the debt, and let him go. But when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed him and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, be patient with me, and I will pay it back. But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said. I cancelled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you? in anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. This is how the Heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart. Come, let us ask the Lord to open our minds so that we can understand it. Firstly, his reading, and then also the message, to hear what he has to say to each and every one of us today. So come, let us come before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Oh, gracious Lord, we have praised you this morning. We've heard your word to us, Lord. And Lord, we don't always understand what it is that you want to say to us. So Lord, this morning we just want to pray that you will help us to understand, that you will speak to our hearts and speak to our minds, and that you will open them and that we will receive your message and your word today. But Lord, help us not just to receive it, but let us absorb it and make it part of our life so that truly we may practice what it is that you want from us. Oh Lord, as I bring your message to these your people, I pray that you will take control of me and that each and every word and meditation that may flow from my lips will be your words, Lord, and that they will bring you honor and glory at all times. So, Father, we pray, hold each and every one of us now very tightly. Embrace us with your peace and speak to us and be with us. And this we pray in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. As we prepare ourselves for the message this morning, let us praise the Lord. Let us sing to the Lord that wonderful song, "The Lord's My Shepherd, I Shall Not Want."
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul. And I will trust in you. And I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me. Your goodness will lead. Guides my ways in righteousness, and he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on his pure delights, and I will trust in you, and I will trust in you alone, for your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me. And though I walk the darkest path,
Something I want to talk to you about this morning is that when we take a look at the statistics of South Africa, we will find that it is claimed that 80% of our population, it's actually 80% plus of our population, claim to be Christian. They claim to be followers of Jesus Christ. Now that is a wonderful stat, and it's wonderful to know that the statistics of our country are great, and with the greater majority of the people are Christian in our country. But I look around me and I look at the news and I just wonder, because I see the absolute hatred amongst people. I see how little a life is worth and how people get killed for as little as 2 rand, and that life has no meaning to one another. Just as I start this, I think back in the years, a couple of years ago, I had a friend down who had a business in Elsie's Rivier, and I'm referring back to about 15, 16 years. A guy with the name of Adam Benoos. He was a man who was a big friend of mine, and he was also a legal arms dealer in this country. And one day, as he was locking up his shop and leaving and walking out, and on the sidewalk, he was approached by a guy who demanded money and had him at gunpoint. And Adam took out his wallet, and all that Adam had in his wallet was a 2 rand coin. This guy took the 2 rand coin, but as he left, he shot Adam as well. So for 2 rand, Adam lost his life. And this is the absolute disrespect that people have for life. I look around at gender-based violence in our country nowadays, and it is rife, and we see how woman upon woman get murdered, women get abused, get assaulted, and this is by people who have a very good standing in the community. We see how the patriarchal system is so active and alive in our country that there is still a very heavy discrimination between genders. Need I expound on robberies, on thefts, on murders, on rape? And this is so crazy. Some people even wonder, and they turn around and through the negativity of what's going on in our country, they ask, where is God? They even go as far as saying, is there a God? Does God exist? But you know, I think it's a question that is very unfair, because it's a question that passes the buck and puts the blame of our sins onto God and saying, but this is God that is causing this to happen. And if God was there, wouldn't he intervene? But you know what? It is the people's choice to make these and do these things, showing and exhibiting a heart that is not filled with love, but a heart that is filled with hatred, jealousy, and anxiousness, because these people are wanting to have the best for themselves, and they will not allow anybody else to have anything. The old saying of the Old Testament, an eye for an eye, is still very, very prevalent today, and it gets me worried, because Jesus teaches us a totally new way of life. In actual fact, he says, when you get hit, just turn the other cheek. So revenge, he teaches, is wrong, and we do not respond with revenge. My mother always used to teach me before she passed away. She always used to teach me and said to me, you know, John, two wrongs don't make a right. But if somebody wrongs you, you must forgive them, or else you will sell your soul. Now, in our passage today, in our lesson today, we see that Jesus here himself does a teaching on this forgiveness after Peter asks him. He asks him of, Lord, how many times must I forgive? It's as if Peter acknowledges that he must forgive, and he also acknowledges that he must forgive more than once, because that is why he asked Jesus. And then in the passage he says, and he asks Jesus the question, he says, up to seven times? But Jesus responds in a manner which is totally, totally different to what we are used to. You know, we become used to life and we would normally say, we'll give a guy a second chance, but there's no way for a third chance and not a fourth chance. And when a guy wrongs us, we say to him, we say normally, that is it. This guy has had his chance. He's made a mistake. He's hurt me and he's hurt me again. Now it's over. I will not forgive him because he is not going to turn from his ways. But Jesus says that when we forgive, we must not forgive seven times, but 70 times seven times. In other words, he doesn't necessarily attach a certain amount to how many times we must forgive, but he says we must forgive endlessly and we must continually forgive when people wrong us. And Jesus here acknowledges, he says that we are going to be wronged and people are going to hurt us and people are going to abuse our trust. And he says, but we must forgive them every time. Every time we must forgive them. And I know it's difficult. It's very difficult to do something like that because every time we get hurt. But out of that hurt, we must learn. We must learn to be weary. And we must learn to strengthen ourselves so that when the hurt comes again, the impact is not as great as it was the first time. But Jesus then goes over and telling the parable of the servant who, after begging his master, gets forgiven all his debts. And he says, you can go. And his debt is cancelled. But yet, when that same servant goes out, and he goes into the world and he finds somebody that owes him some money, owes him 100 shekels, silver coins. And this guy, he goes to him and he doesn't even ask him nicely. He just grabs him and he starts choking him and he says, when are you going to pay me? And he demands the money and he demands those coins. And exactly what he does to his master, this guy does to him, and he says, please, give me a chance. Be patient with me. I will pay you back. And what does he do? He does not forgive him. And he has him thrown into prison until he can pay back that debt. So he does the direct opposite of what God or his master did for him. And this is here where Matthew records and he gives us a glimpse, Jesus gives us a glimpse of the wonderful grace that we receive from God. He says that God forgives and he forgives over and over and over again, but as he forgives, so he says, we must also forgive. In other words, the grace that God has shown and given to us, we must show and give to other people. We must not come and respond and think we are better and we must not forgive, because God has given us that grace and He wants us to use His grace on other people so that there can be unity. Unity amongst us, that there can be love amongst us, so that there will not be this hatred and animosity amongst us. You see, we must forgive. And when people owe us something and they cannot repay us and they ask us to help, then we should help. Because that's what God did with each and every one of us. He forgave us so that we can be reconciled with Him. He gave us that choice. And He says, and when people hurt us or people owe us, we should forgive them and scrap that debt so that we can still have a relationship and that we can still love one another. We should not allow earthly things to get in the way of our relationships, but we should love no matter what. My last point I want to ask you this morning, and it's a question, and I want you to think very carefully before you answer this one, because this is a very, very deep and far-reaching question. But you know, in practice, we can say we forgive very easily. We see on television how on the news, how when people have been murdered, how the surviving family, be it the spouse, be it the child, very easily says on television, you know what, I have forgiven the guy that has killed my father or my mother, and I want to move on with my life. And it shows how this person goes and how this person goes and sees the perpetrator. And they talk. And this person says, I forgive you. Now, we also say, you know what? I will forgive this person or I will forgive that person. And it's easy to say it. It's easy to say it. But there's one question I want to ask you today. And this is the one that is important, that you must think very carefully on what I'm saying. Because I've asked this to very many people, and a lot of very many people have become angry with me on asking this question. When you forgive somebody, when does that person's punishment stop? In other words, if somebody has hurt you, you forgive that person, when do you reconcile yourself to that person again? When do you set that person free from the bondage you have put on that person? You see, because when Jesus went to the cross, He forgave our sins because He took all our sins on us. He died, He paid the price. But then through that, He made reconciliation to the Father possible. So we have been set free from the bondage of sin. So my question to you is, when do you stop punishing the person that has hurt you? And I want to give you a classic example. And I know this may get your hair up a little bit, but please forgive me. But I think it's the best illustration to illustrate what I'm saying. We all know the Oscar Pistorius endaba and how he shot Reeva Steenkamp. Now, please, I'm not going into the nitty-gritty on whether he was guilty or whether he was not guilty, whether it was done on purpose or whether it was not done on purpose. Please, I want us to stay away from that. But what I want to ask you this morning is that Reeva Steenkamp's parents said publicly to everybody that, Oscar, we forgive you. And they even went to Oscar and said that they forgive him. That's wonderful. It's amazing. But when Oscar came to his parole hearing, whether he could be set free on parole, what happened? Reeva Steenkamp's parents were there and they said, no, we cannot agree to Oscar going out on parole. So that's why my question comes, when does the punishment stop? You see, when you forgive, the punishment has to stop. That is exactly what happened with Jesus and God with us. Because the day Jesus went to the cross, he took our punishment on him, then he sacrificed his life. Thus, all our sins were paid for by his life. Not our life, by his life, and therefore our punishment stopped. Now, this is where a lot of confusion comes in with Christianity. You see, it's not about our sins, and it's not about how good or how bad we are, but it's whether we try and live a life the way Jesus wants us to live it, and whether we are in a relationship with Jesus Christ that saves us. So it's not no matter how good or bad you are. So you see, because we're in a relationship with Jesus, our punishment has stopped and Jesus has forgiven us. So I guess what I'm saying is that we must forgive. But when we forgive, we must stop punishing those people and we must be reconciled with them. And together we must proclaim this world for Jesus Christ. There's that wonderful song, and we're going to play it at the end of this service. That, and they'll know we are Christians by our love. And that is what is meant when we forgive. So when people hurt us over and over and over again, we must forgive them and we must stop punishing them. In the case of the parents of Reeva Steenkamp, who opposed parole, their forgiveness was not sincere because they could not stop the punishment. So what I'm saying now is that when we forgive, we must stop punishing the people who have hurt us, or else our forgiveness is not sincere, it's not true, and it's not genuine. Folks, it's a difficult thing to do. It's easy to say I forgive, but it's not that easy to stop punishing, and we have to do that. The wonderful thing is that through the grace of God, he gives us the strength and he gives us the power to do just that. Because it is through his eyes and it is through his love that we are able to love those that hurt us. It is through his grace that we are able to forgive those so that truly we can be reconciled with them. Folks, I want you to go, and this is your challenge for the week. I want you to go and think on exactly the question I asked you. Is when you forgive, when does the punishment stop? Our punishment has been stopped because we are reconciled with Almighty God through Jesus Christ. Are you reconciled with Jesus, or are you going to be treated the way that the servant treated the other servant? I cannot answer that question for you. I leave that in your hands. My prayer for you is that you will forgive and forgive 70 times up to 7, and that you will be reconciled with those people that hurt you. That is my prayer for you. Amen. We've heard the Lord's word to us. So come, let us ask him to help us to effect that in our lives. Come, let us pray. Oh, gracious Lord, we've heard Your word to us, we've heard how your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, spoke to the disciples on forgiveness. But Lord, it is something that we struggle with day in and day out. Help us, Lord, to forgive sincerely. Help us to forgive more than once, multiple times, 70 times, 7 times, so that truly we may affect your grace that you've given us, that we can show other people the wonderful grace that you've given to us. Oh Lord, as we do this, we pray that you will help us, because in our own strength, we battle to reconcile with people that hurt us. We battle to reconcile with people that we cannot trust. We battle to be in a relationship. But you've taught us today that no matter what, our love should be unconditional, so that together we can proclaim your kingdom. Oh Lord, we want to thank you for this wonderful opportunity that you give each and every one of us. We thank you that we are able to be reconciled with you. We thank you for the relationship that we are in with Jesus Christ. We thank you that he is our Redeemer and that he is our Lord. Oh Lord, as we go into this world, help us to realize that you are with us and that we must love one another with your love, and that that love must be unconditional, forgiving those that hurt us and giving them a second, a third, a fourth, and a fifth chance if need be. But help us to see them through your eyes. Help them, help us to love them with your love. Give us the strength and the courage to do just that. Thank you, Lord, that you are there with us to help us in this. Thank you, Lord, that you bless each and every one of us. Thank you that you hear our prayers. So, Father, we pray today in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Let us conclude our service by praising the Lord in song. As I mentioned earlier in the message, I want us to sing that song. You know, my daughter Amber Lee says that if ever there should be a theme for all Christians, a motto for all Christians, it should be this song. And this song is so relevant to us today. And it goes, "For they'll know we are Christians by our love." By our love. And this is an old song which has been revamped and modernized, but I want you to focus on the words, because the words are so important. In the one verse it goes, "And we will work side by side." In other words, a people reconciled to one another and a people reconciled to Almighty God. So join together in singing and sing it aloud.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that our unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, yes they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand, we will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand, and together Christian.
And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know.
Receive now the blessing. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of His Holy Spirit be with us here now today and forevermore. Amen. And may God bless each and every one of you with His richest blessing until we meet again. Folks, our time has come to an end once again. It's been an honor and a privilege to come into your homes or wherever you may be and just to share God's word with you. I pray God's blessing on you for this new week. May He be there to guide you and may He be there to protect you and keep you safe. So until we meet again, stay safe, stay healthy, and always remember that God is there for you. Is only a prayer away. Goodbye now.
May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the softly on your fields, and until we meet again, may you keep safe in the gentle loving arms of God.
For everything there is a season, a time for meeting, a time to say goodbye. In all things, God's near, always guiding your way.
May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine. Gentle loving arms of God.
For everything there is a season, a time for laughter, a time for tears and pain. In all things God is near, always guiding your sunshine warm upon your face.
Safe in the gentle